The way we've structured this panel is that Dr. Keel is going to do a short presentation to introduce the topic of neuroscience and psychopathy. It's a hard word to say. Then we're going to go to asking questions of all the different panel members, and I will turn it over to Dr. Keel.
Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction and for the invitation to speak to you today. So I am a neuroscientist. I study your brains, essentially. And what we're going to do is run through to try to kick off this symposium, a kind of the usual suspect, so to speak, and what neuroscience might have to offer in terms of helping to understand individuals who have different personality disorders or problems or mental illness. Or just aberrant behavior generally. So your first client that you're studying or that you have to defend is named Brad. And Brad's a 40-year-old male. He has a normal IQ. Like many in California, he's been divorced and remarried. He has no history of psychiatric illness and oddly, has worked as a correctional officer for a while. He's also then worked as a school teacher. 16 years ago, he hit his head, knocked himself unconscious, but had no kind of neurological events following that. And for the last 2 years, he's had some migraines. Brad also started using pornography on the internet. He's admitted to this. He started soliciting sex from women working at massage parlors in 2010. He reports that he has a very high sex drive, and he conceals this behavior because he feels that it is wrong. And there's a picture of Brad here. In 2010, Brad makes some subtle sexual advances to his stepdaughter. Mom finds out about this, and Brad is legally removed from the home and diagnosed as a pedophile. He is chemically castrated in treatment to try to reduce his poor sexual behavior. He's found guilty of child molestation, and he is sentenced to either an inpatient sexual addiction facility or jail. And Brad chooses rehab, so he goes to the sexual-based addiction. Rehab. In rehab, he starts being inappropriate with staff. He starts to try to solicit sex from other clients in rehab. He's expelled. Brad also has, oddly, some bedwetting, which is a neurological symptom at this age, 40 years old. He's also, the night before he goes to prison, he complains of a headache. And the doctors say, well, this headache's pretty severe, so we're going to send you and get an MRI. And they do an MRI, and it looks like this. Now, you guys don't look at this every day like I do. But this is, you might not quite see it there, but this is a tumor. This is ventricles. That's the fluid-filled part of your brain. Another way to look at it is like this. Yeah, that's not good, right, when you see something like this on an MRI scan. So the question is this tumor related to his aberrant behavior that he's started to have? And now what you find is that this huge tumor, is resected, and he's recovered from all the different memory and other types of problems. He goes right through and aces a Sexaholics Anonymous course. He's then returned home, and his wife takes him back in because he is supposedly cured. So Brad's just been arrested again. This is what you're dealing with as a public defender, again, for trying to sexually assault his stepdaughter, and now he's assigned to be your client. Do you order another MRI? And you do, and guess what? The tumor's back. And so the question is this brain science relevant at some level to Brad's sentencing or Brad's treatment or Brad's mitigation? So we'll talk about that. Now you have another kid. Here you have a child. He's 16-year-old. He's got above average IQ. He's done very well in high school. No history of head injury or drug use. He's involved in sporting activities and other types of social activities. And one night he's out with some friends. There's a fight over a rival football game. And Justin hits another teen in the head. The teen ends up in a serious coma with a head injury. Justin is charged with attempted murder and use of a weapon, amongst other things. And here's his mugshot. the prosecution says that they want to raise Justin to adult court and seek a sentence of life without the possibility of parole for attempted murder. But you remember, wait, isn't there something about this? Maybe the Supreme Court has talked about this. And it turns out that in 2009, Graham v. Florida, the Supreme Court eliminated the sentence of life without the possibility of parole for non-homicide cases. And why did they do this? Well, for the first time, the Supreme Court cited adolescent neuroscience as being relevant to their decision making. And so the Supreme Court was given this video, which you'll see here. This is a 12-year-old brain, and what happens over time is a 12-year-old brain develops. And if this works, hey, you'll watch the brain start to mature until you hit about 24 or 25 and you reach full maturation. So, now, for those of you that are parents, you don't need a brain scan to say that your child is a different brain than when they were an adolescent. And for those of us that went through adolescence, we know it was a time of heightened impulsivity and poor decision making, et cetera, and we might have all gotten ourselves in a little bit of trouble. But the Supreme Court needs a picture of a brain in order to make a decision that adolescents have different levels of responsibility. So another way to look at this is here, so that we can see there's this very nice development of neuronal change over time that's associated with changes in cognition and changes in how you, process, view the world, and make decisions. Okay. Now you have another client named George. George is a 55-year-old white male offender. He's had a lifetime of history of getting in and out of jail for minor petty crimes and things like that, petty crimes. His IQ estimate is very low. George has a very low IQ. Previously, they might have referred to him as being retarded, other types of things in the DSM. He's arrested now for murder, and the prosecution is seeking the death penalty. And Atkins v. Virginia, the Supreme Court said that you're not allowed to execute individuals who have low IQ. But I get phone calls all the time from count defense expert says his IQ is 60, too low to execute. Prosecution says his IQ is 72, high enough to execute. So what can neuroscience do? Is there anything that neuroscience can do? Oh, that's George. Actually, I'm just kidding. Actually, this is George. So what do we know about the neuroscience of gray matter, about your brain? What can I tell you about that? Well, so the bad news is that as you get older, gray matter goes down. I did this quick analysis on my computer here before I came in to give this talk over the weekend, and all of these areas that I'm showing you there in blue, this is the bottom of the brain, those are your eyeballs, these are slices going all the way up through the top, and no, I didn't slice my own brain up to do this, I took a picture of it. And all these areas that you see here in blue are going down as you get older. That's aging. It sucks. I'm getting older. And so what do you think? The tumor area, by the way, of poor decision making is right up in there. And so you're seeing that gray matter in the brain changes over time as you age. It also turns out that gray matter is highly correlated with IQ. So depending on the type of how we measure IQ, we find a nice relationship between IQ and gray matter. So I'm showing these just statistical maps and these beautiful color images that neuroscientists love to play with. And so now I can show you these maps. And guess what? It turns out that I don't actually need to even test you for IQ. I could take your brain and put it in my algorithm, and it's going to tell me what your IQ is. It's going to fit it to a distribution of thousands of other people in the world, and we're going to be able to tell you probably better than your prosecution's witness or your defense witness what your actual true IQ is. Isn't that neat? That's what neuroscience is likely to do in the very near future. Okay, now you have this client. Anyone know who that is?
Hinckley.
Exactly. That's Hinckley. And Hinckley was a 26-year-old male who tried to assassinate President Reagan. Hinckley said that he did the crime, which he did, to try to gain the affection, which he did not, of Jodie Foster. And Hinckley pled insanity, and brain images were used for the very first time in this case. And what they used to support the diagnosis that he was psychotic, that is, he heard voices, he had hallucinations, he had other types of delusions, that, and particularly his belief about Jodie Foster. And the brain images at the time were something called enlarged ventricles, which are the fluid-filled spaces in the brain. We know that it's not diagnostic now of having psychosis, it's a risk factor. If you have enlarged ventricles, you're more likely than if you don't have large ventricles to develop these types of illnesses. But Hinckley was found insane based on this information and others, and sentenced to an insane asylum. And Hinckley's actually been now released starting in 2009, 2010, on day parole to visit his family, his parents, they're still alive, and he's been just fine. He hasn't had any, he's well treated and managed, and he's been out now since then. Sorry, I already summarized that because they told me I had to go way faster. Now it's actually easy. If you happen to have schizophrenia or you hear voices or hallucinations, it is with 99% certainty I can show that your brain is different than someone who doesn't have those. In fact, if you have schizophrenia versus control, just pretend like you're a little pattern classifier. What do you see that's different? Well, you see how these areas here are much different. They're much more engaged than those areas there, comparing these three to those three. You might see that there's a lot more blue as well in this map than in these maps. And look at this area right there. It's very different than that area, much more engaged in a control individual than in a patient. And then if you have bipolar illness, another type of mental illness, you're even different than if you have schizophrenia. And in fact, when patients present to the emergency room and they're psychotic, they could have this illness or this illness. Those are the two most common, and physicians can't tell the difference, but our MRI scanners can, okay? So this is the point. So psychiatry is moving towards using these imaging systems to help improve psychiatric diagnosis. And the legal system is like, ooh, I can actually use this instead of a psychiatrist to actually support whether or not my client has a mental illness or not. And then they would be able to inform and make decisions about how these things should be used then in the legal system. This is the so-called intersection of neuroscience and law. But what about this guy? Anthony Hopkins in full Hannibal Lecter regalia. What does his brain look like? So let me teach you psychology 101. If your behavior is completely different, your brain is going to be different. Men versus women. Women, you all know the men have different behavior, correct? Yeah? They have different brains than you do. And so our MRI systems now are exquisitely capable of telling you how those gender differences manifest in terms of structure and function. And we can also map and study people like him. So psychopathy is what I study. I study individuals we call psychopaths. And if you want to look at your spousal score on this, you know, see me later. Individuals with psychopathy have a profound inability to really appreciate or lack empathy, guilt, and remorse, and they're extremely callous. Those are some of the central things. So let me give you my interpretation of how to understand this. So how many of you have seen a judge ask a defendant, do you feel any remorse for what you've done? Yeah, almost everyone, right? At least on TV. How many of you, and you look at that defendant, and sometimes that defendant doesn't have a good answer to that question, et cetera, what are you going to do? So here, let me give you this question. How many of you can solve this equation? Now you know how a psychopath feels when he's asked about remorse. It's a blank slate. This is one of Einstein's field equations for the theory of general relativity. There's probably only three people in the world that can solve this equation. The point is that individuals who lack this ability that most of us take for granted, empathy, guilt, and remorse, that's how they feel when you're asked about empathy, guilt, and remorse. So hopefully I've given you just a touch of psychopathy for a nanosecond there. So now go back. Oh, sorry, PC error. Move that thing over there all the way to the right. My apologies. So how do we study people like him? Well, we can transport him, right, out from the prison to the hospital and scan them. But one of the things that my lab does is we built a really nice trailer in New Mexico. Here's my trailer. Yes, I know the jokes are coming. I live in a trailer in New Mexico. And but this trailer has a really nice MRI in it. This is a $2 million trailer. And we take this out to various facilities around the country now. And we work with inmates who volunteer for studies of treatment and how to make them better and everything else. And what we've found is that individuals who have those psychopathic traits, only about a third or a quarter of all inmates will score really high on those traits. They have reduced gray matter density in these areas. This is the same area where that guy had that tumor. Okay. This is the same area that decreases when you get older. But these individuals, controlling for all of the important things, history and severity of substance use, age, IQ, any other types of Axis I problems, head injury, et cetera, environment. They're all from, you know, pretty average environments for this population. Extremely different in terms of brain structure. So does this go towards mitigation or aggravation? Or how should it be used? How should this information be used? I use it to try to develop treatments for people like Hannibal Lecter. But that is how I thought we would kickstart our little seminar right now. I'm happy to answer any other questions. But before I do, I have to jump away here and say that I didn't do this all by myself. I had lots of individuals who helped me collect this, work with this data. And in particular, this research is all funded by the National Institutes of Health, your tax dollars, to help us try to do this. And so with that, I'll thank you for your attention and turn it back over to our moderator, who will ask us lots of tough questions. Thank you.
Actually, I'd like to, I'm going to ask a few questions, but I was hoping that we could get a debate going here rather than with me trying to ask intelligent questions and just have the very smart people just talking amongst themselves to educate us. So one of the questions that we're wanted to talk about today was the idea of free will in terms of the criminal justice system. And I would like to ask each of you, is there a definition of free will in the context of your individual work? And we'll start with you, Dr. Keel.
I would punt that one right over to David, who is the expert in free will. And then we actually spent all last night debating this, but why not David starts.
Okay.
Did you consciously choose to do that? I think that free will is a mainly unhelpful concept, and I think that you have to ask the question from the legal system and from the science perspective as to what free will might mean. On the science side, the question really is, and this is what we were debating, is the question whether you can operationally define free will so you can measure it. From a scientist standpoint, a construct doesn't really mean anything if you can't measure it. And I've asked many, many neuroscientists, including Kent, well, what exactly does free will mean, and how do you measure it? And it could be something like volitional control. It could be something like impulsivity or impulse control. And you get back to the basic problem that Chris Lobogan, who is a colleague of Anita's at Vanderbilt, the way he's put it, is how do you distinguish an irresistible impulse from an impulse not resisted? And there's a basic gray area, a difficult ability to say, did you actually choose that, and did you choose it in a way that the law would recognize? So the law all of the time develops concepts that scientists are interested in studying. It might be competency, for example. Well, competency is really a multifaceted construct from a legal perspective. It could be competency to be executed. It could be competency to commit a crime. It could be competency to contribute to the decision whether to voluntarily commit yourself to a mental hospital. It could be competency to participate in an abortion decision. And so competency means many different things. And so the first thing you have to do as a scientist is ask the question, well, what does the law mean by it? Because if you want me to measure it, I have to somehow apply it. So going back to the question of free will, because the scientists can't operationally define it, they can't measure it, they're not really that much use to legal debates about free will. Now, what does it mean on the legal side? I actually think the idea of free will, or what's often referred to as volitional control, plays a very big part in legal systems. But I think in legal systems, we don't mean it empirically. We don't mean it as a factual construct. We don't mean that there's actually this idea that somebody has free will and has made a conscious choice, and that we can somehow measure it. I think that in the criminal law, what we mean by free will is essentially a conclusion. It's not a premise, it's a conclusion. We have concluded that the person should have and will take responsibility for their action, and therefore they had free will and they're going to take the consequences for that. The problem is when we start actually believing the rhetoric, we actually start believing what we're saying. If you think that if you use free will normatively, that is used as a value judgment about when somebody should have to take responsibility, and you use it that way in the criminal law, what happens is it starts bleeding over into what I call the quasi-criminal law, which is civil commitment. In the civil commitment area, we also use this notion of free will that, again, we call volitional control. But we use it, and the classic example today, because it's so high profile, are sexually violent predators. Sexually violent predators under constitutional doctrine, under the Supreme Court's two decisions in Kansas versus Hendricks and Kansas versus Crane, the Supreme Court said that under the Constitution, in order to civilly commit, to not criminally, but to civilly commit a sexually violent predator, you have to demonstrate two independent factual constructs. One is you have to demonstrate lack of volitional control, which is defined legislatively as mental abnormality, which often gets defined as a personality disorder, antisocial personality disorder. And the second construct you have to prove is that they're likely to be violent in the future. Now, on the civil side, those both ought to be factual judgments. Does the person lack volitional control, and is the person likely to be violent in the future? If, however, we are actually using at least the first construct, not empirically, but we're using it normatively, then we are potentially violating two provisions of the Constitution, the Ex Post Facto Clause and the Double Jeopardy Clause. Because what you're essentially doing is calling upon the fact finder, whether it's a judge or a jury, you're calling upon the fact finder to make a judgment about whether the person is mentally abnormal, defined as substantial lack of volitional control, but we've never actually operationally defined what lack of volitional control is, so an expert can't come in and testify that this person, as a factual matter, lacks volitional control. So then what's doing the work? Well, what's doing the work is the fact that the person has behaved badly in the past. And because they didn't control their behavior in the past, they are therefore likely not to be able to control their behavior today and tomorrow. But if you basically define lack of volitional control as past bad acts, then you're back in the realm of essentially punishing them a second time for their original acts, which by definition is a violation of the Ex Post Facto and Double Jeopardy clauses. So part of the problem that I see is our inability to define a legal construct that we consider, if you think about it not too deeply, as a factual concern. But the scientists say, well, I don't understand that as a factual matter and I can't define or measure it, then the law is just sort of set free to use normative value-based considerations in making decisions about civil commitment.
Dr. Farhani, or Professor Farhani.
All right, so I'm going to do this a little bit shorter, I think, which is let's start with a question to everybody in the audience. All right, so if you like chocolate cake, raise your left hand. And if you do not like chocolate cake, raise your right hand. So all people who like chocolate cake, left hand, don't like chocolate cake, right hand. All right, hands down. How many people found it difficult to raise your hand by yourself? Not very many, right? You made a choice. You thought about it. You decided, and you acted. And my concept of what free will is the ability to act consistent with your preferences and desires. Just that simple. Now, how many people here feel like you have control over whether or not you like chocolate cake? Raise either hand. Fewer, right? So there are two different things going on that we often conflate when we talk about free will. One is your predispositions to preferences and desires, okay? And that may be impulsivity, that may be violence, that may be antisocial personality disorder, that may be a preference for chocolate cake, a preference for sugar. I did my 23andMe profile. If you don't know what that is, it's a really neat genetic thing that you can go online and you give a little saliva sample and it tells you a bunch of things about predispositions for entertainment value. And it says, I need 16 grams more sugar than the average person per day. You could know that by looking in my purse because I have a bunch of Twizzlers in there, which I enjoy. And I have very little control over my preferences and desires, but I do have a choice. Do I buy Twizzlers? Do I buy the super sugary candy? Do I eat the chocolate cake? The question in my mind is the disaggregation of these two things. Are you compelled, based on your preferences and desires, to act, to raise your hands, to take a gun and fire it? Or are you not? And it turns out neuroscience helps us answer that question somewhat in that there are a number of studies that try to look at the flexibility of actions. And it finds that you maintain significant flexibility of action up until the moment where you make a choice to act. We can actually see actions in the brain. We can see you deciding and choosing between actions in the brain. And we can see the flexibility of choice that you maintain. Now, this difference between law and theory as to freedom of action versus freedom of choice, I think it actually is quite compatible across both. If we simply separate what it is that we're talking about, a difference between your preferences and desires over which you may not have control versus action choices. And in law, we punish you for bad actions, not for bad preferences and desires. And so then the question is, how do we take account for preferences and desires that may be outside of your control, That may be things like gray matter, like Kent showed us, that show that people like psychopaths have, you know, decreased gray matter in particular regions of their brain. It could be something like the guy who he was talking about out of Virginia, who had the large tumor in his brain and chose to act on, but didn't have control over having the tumor in his brain. So how do we take account for that in law? That's, I think, the interesting struggle that neuroscience presents us with. But it doesn't really change this issue of free will. In fact, we have just as robust of evidence now from neuroscience that supports this concept of action, which is what we punish for in law to begin with.
And Dr. Keel, would you like to comment on that last?
No.
No?
Well, I guess I'd like to raise an issue, because I think theoretically that may all be true, but I still think that there's a problem with distinguishing and differentiating those who are compelled to act based on their desires and those who are not. And so if you can't define, and it's not just simply defining it in the brain, but it's defining it genetically, environmentally, contextually, you're defining it in terms of time. If you study their brain today, but they committed the act 6 months ago or a year ago or 10 years ago. So the legal question ultimately is not theoretically whether we can distinguish preferences from action, but whether we can identify those either before the fact or after the fact that had that inability to control their action.
Yeah, but what we do know is that even like the one that Kent presented, the pedophile out of Virginia, that the vast majority of people who have a tumor like that, who may have preferences and desires to act on sexual impulses, don't. And while we may not know in any particular case whether a person is actually an automaton, usually we can. I mean, the law has a pretty bright line. It says, if you have engaged in a wrongful action, there's a very limited defense called the insanity defense, which never works, as most of us know, because we don't recognize it. Now, should we recognize it? That's an interesting question, right? Should we have a more robust concept of diminished responsibility in light of understanding that some people have less control over their preferences and desires? Or should we have better sentencing schemes or get rid of incarceration and come up with different models of trying to deal with punishment once we understand people have wrongful actions? I think those are all interesting questions. But is there free will? Well, the fact that almost everybody in the audience raised either their right or left hand, contemplated it, and were quickly able to act and respond, that to me says, yes, there is. Now what do we want to do about it? Now that we understand that those of us in the audience or those of us up here who like chocolate cake may not have control over it, how do we want to account for that, if at all, in the criminal justice system? To date, we haven't. In the future, we may wish to.
Well, I agree with that. I think that, well, first of all, the fact that everybody in the audience could control themselves for raising their hands gives me some comfort as I walk out the door. but one of the problems with the disconnect that I was alluding to earlier between how science deals with this question, how lawyers deal with this question, is that you actually get a fundamental disconnect between the two systems. So you mentioned that lack of volitional control or lack of ability to control your preferences might lead to insanity. But in fact, in most jurisdictions, as of course you know, that's not true. After Hinckley was acquitted under the American Law Institute test because he could not control his behavior, Congress in most state jurisdictions changed the law, got rid of the substantial lack of volitional control test from the old American Law Institute, the ALI test, and now in most jurisdictions, the McNaughton test applies. The McNaughton test requires that you demonstrate that you can't distinguish right from wrong. So now we have, and again, the law uses science for the law's own purposes, but what is problematic here is that disconnect. So on the criminal side, if you lack volitional control, you go to prison because you can't win under the McNaughton test because the LLI test doesn't apply. When you walk out of prison and you lack volitional control, you get civilly committed. And so what we have is a fundamental disconnect between how we view philosophy of free will and human control on the criminal side versus the civil side, and not surprisingly, on both sides, quote, the state wins, because on the criminal side, you go to prison, and on the civil side, you get incarcerated civilly.
I don't think that's much of a disconnect. I think So I agree with you, the test has changed. That's not what I'm talking about. If you look at the kind of distribution of behavior, right, if we think that the people at this high end of the distribution have kind of perfect control of their impulses and perfect control over acting on their preferences. So I like chocolate cake, but it gives me migraines, so I try to not actually have it because it tends to trigger it. So maybe I end up over on the normal distribution at the higher end. And at this end, we have people who have complete lack of control over their impulses. What the law currently does is it just draws a bright line. And it says, normatively, right, as a matter of who we think we should hold responsible, only people who are at this end of the line are going to be held to not be responsible agents, people who we will not hold accountable for their actions. And we deal with that right now with the insanity defense. Do I think that's perfect? No. Do we maybe want to shift the line a little bit further over on the normal curve as we understand that a great degree more people have difficulty controlling their impulses or controlling their behavior or being able to act in a manner that is consistent with a higher level desire to act responsibly than maybe a lower level desire to act violently? Maybe we want to shift the line, but right now, where society has chosen to draw the line is to be pretty harsh with respect to who we will include as people who are agents of responsibility versus non-agents of responsibility. You know, neuroscience could change that. Once we understand and have a better understanding of human behavior and we recognize that there is a much finer gradation that we could draw than this bright line, perhaps we'll shift the line or start over. But it's not all that consistent, inconsistent with the way we do things.
Well, I think it is inconsistent. Vicki, you wanted a little bit of debate. We have a little bit of debate.
I'd like to jump in at some point.
Let me just say that what we have is two distributions. You have one distribution based on, quote, free will or volitional control, which applies on the civil side and used to apply under the ALI test. And now we have a new distribution of being able to distinguish right from wrong. So now we have two completely different distributions that we're drawing that bright line
on. Cognitive versus volitional. And I don't think that, I mean, we can decide that cognitive isn't sufficient, but it is the basis where we draw the line. But Becca, sorry.
It's okay. Dr. Keel, to get back to the science, do you see how the research that you're doing and this imaging and identification of areas in the brain that may be part of primarily psychopathy, which we're talking about today, how would that be used in a courtroom? What's your opinion?
Classically, individuals who have those traits, the lack of empathy, guilt, and remorse, those traits tend to predict future recidivism. So if you're an offender and you are scored very high on those traits, you have a 4 to 8 times increased risk of reoffending when you're released than if you're an inmate who scores low on those traits. So it's classically been considered as a construct an aggravating or future dangerousness issue, and it's routinely used in risk assessment. I think that what the literature has done is it's helped us to understand that there are since their brains are very different, they're very affectively challenged, even if you will. Some attorneys have made the argument that that psychopathy constitutes an affective disturbance or something that would be mitigating, for example, in the context of a death penalty sentencing. Mm-hmm. And I've certainly been asked to testify about whether or not psychopaths have affective deficits. And absolutely, they have affective deficits. There's been hundreds of years of psychiatric research showing that they do. And so you have this two-pronged thing. You have this one hand that they're more dangerous if you release them than if you don't treat them. And on the other hand, they're affectively different. There was a very nice article in the New York Times Magazine on Mother's Day about children who have these emerging traits and how we would develop and understand them and treat them. And that's a small percentage of individuals and kids. But my goal is to try to develop better treatments so that they can keep them off that trajectory towards life course persistent problems.
Are you saying then that people who have this brain structure that you've identified will always be lacking in volitional control or impulsive to the extent that they are criminals? I mean, do we have a subset of people who are just criminals because of their brains?
No, I should really differentiate psychopathy from criminality. I mean, there's a lot of, and you heard today, a lot of reasons why individuals engage in different criminal activity. Individual psychopathy are a very small percentage of prisoners. They're just about 15 to 20%, depending on security level. Those individuals are the ones that present the highest risk for reoffending. Those are the ones that we say have the personality disorders, et cetera. There's some amazingly good treatment programs that have been developed, especially with youth, that can show upwards of a 50% reduction in violent crime in kids with these traits if you put them in the right type of treatment. And the state of Wisconsin leads the way in this regard, by the way, because they've invested heavily in these types of treatment programs. And they show these dramatic effects. And that, to me, gives me faith that other states, California hopefully and others, will adopt these very progressive and positive reinforcement kind of model change of behavior treatment programs. And they have the power to reduce impulsivity and increase a little bit of empathy that allows that person, when they're released, to not act without thinking, or to act less likely to act without thinking, and then to also potentially engage in better, general better societal behaviors.
We briefly mentioned mitigation and aggravation. Professor Fagman, could you address the question of how you would use this information either as aggravation or mitigation in a potentially a death penalty case? Do you have any opinions about that?
Well, a couple observations. First, it's worth noting that in most jurisdictions, the rules of evidence, whether it's the Kelly Frey test in California or the Daubert rule in federal jurisdictions, does not apply at capital sentencing. So many of the questions about how valid the research is and how robust it is doesn't necessarily come up because the standards are much lower in capital sentencing. I think it's a huge question. You could have exactly the same brain scan on the prosecution side, as Kent pointed out. These are dangerous people. Many of them will say straight up, if you let me go, I'm going to do it again, and I really can't control myself. And that sounds aggravating. On the other side of it, we are, to some extent, the victims of either our preferences or inability to control our preferences. We're victims of our environments growing up. We're victims of our context that we live in. And therefore, we all, are not, quote, responsible for that behavior, and therefore should be mitigating. And when you look at a lot of the testimony that comes in, whether it's from a mother or from neighbors or from teachers that are talking about really mitigating circumstances, they are the rotten social background kind of arguments, the abuse and the suffering that individual experienced, and those things show up in the brain. The brain is also a sponge. The brain isn't simply created by genetics, and it's very much shaped by environment. And so my mentor, John Monahan, likened the problem of predicting violent people to predicting violent storms. When you think of meteorology and you think of the difficulty of classifying a hurricane and then tracking a hurricane, making judgments about such complex behavior that has sort of chaotic premises underlying it, you're going to make lots of mistakes. You're going to make lots of mistakes in both directions. Sometimes you're going to make a mistake when you think that the storm's going to hit, and it doesn't, and sometimes you're going to make mistakes where you think the storm's not going to hit, and it does. I think one of the great challenges, quite frankly, for the legal system is understanding statistics well enough to make that judgment about where you draw that line that Nita was referring to, where do you want to avoid the errors. You want to avoid the errors if you think a Category 5 hurricane is going to hit Miami, but there's only a 40% likelihood that hurricane is going to hit Miami. Do you evacuate the city? Well, if you evacuate the city and it doesn't hit, you spent tons of money and possibly hurt lots of people in doing that. If you don't evacuate the city and the storm hits, then you have many deaths and much lost money. And I think it's that statistical judgment that ultimately is the legal judgment that has to be made here. And the best science will never get to that point where it will say, we know with 100% certainty that this person is going to commit another offense or is not going to commit another offense. This is our confidence about that judgment. And now you have to work with that in the best way you can.
But those are when I do these education outreach to federal judges, that's the biggest questions. And generally, they want to know, can you help me do any better than my best clinical judgment? And I'm like, yeah, we can. We can help design tests that help to predict better than just the average clinician. And they want to know, how good can you get? And risk assessments are getting better. I mean, they're getting a lot better. I look at risk assessments as I've identified the variables that promote risk so that I can develop treatment strategies to reduce those risks. And so if you have somebody that scores very high in psychopathy and has all the other risk factors that would suggest they're going to be an 80% chance of reoffending, you know, in 4 or 5 years, you could develop a tiered or strategic release plan that would help to mitigate those risk factors so that that person can be, levels of risk can be brought down. And that's how we think about risk management. I call it typically risk needs assessment, because once you understand the risks, then you can develop ways of mediating them. And whether or not that's a brain difference or a picture of a scan or whatever it is, your brain changes as you age. I tried to show you that. And that change can be done through a lot of different ways, through education, through learning, through treatment, through talking to people, or medicines all have big impacts on how the brain develops and changes over time.
Dr. Farhani, or Professor Farhani?
Either one's fine. So my view is that this evidence has not been particularly useful either as aggravation or as mitigation. So I've been doing an empirical study over the past 6 years now to look at its introduction in criminal cases. And it's equivocal at best. It sometimes ends up being aggravating. But so far it hasn't panned out. Now, why hasn't it panned out? In part, it's because the science isn't quite there yet, in that we're able to see some things at a group level, but being able to talk about a single individual, to look at their brain and to understand the extent to which their brain differences contribute to their behavior is very challenging. There just isn't enough data for that yet. You can say things at a group-wide level, though. And so Kent mentioned earlier the case out of Florida in the Supreme Court, Graham, in which the court said that juveniles should be treated differently with respect to life without the possibility of parole. The same thing happened in Roper v. Simmons, where the court has treated juveniles differently. And it may be the case that we can start to do that. We can start to categorize people. So in Atkins v. Virginia, we've categorized a group of individuals and said those people who have mental retardation have lesser culpability for a whole host of reasons, including they're more likely to follow people, they're more likely to be subject to peer pressure, less likely to have made premeditated decision making. That's probably where this evidence is the most useful. So we have a standard in criminal law called the reasonable person standard, this fictitious person that we measure everybody's conduct by. We say, this is the person, the average person, the average juror, the average individual, the kind of conduct that we would expect an average member of society to live up to. Well, it just turns out that none of us are quite average, right? And we might actually be much more like people who we share particular brain structures with, or people who we shared particular environmental and brain similarities to. And so we might need to start thinking about more particularized notions of conduct based on what we would expect of a person who has that type of a brain structure, who had these types of environmental factors, and then start to think about how we want to treat them. Do we want to hold those people responsible for their actions or less responsible for their actions? Are there certain people who would be better subject to medical treatment instead of incarceration? Are there certain people who we actually think would be better off being in prison than not being in prison? Those types of decisions, I think, are going to be much more useful coming out of the neuroscience, at least in the near term. In the long term, maybe we can get to the point where we can make individualized decision making with respect to mitigation and aggravation, but so far it hasn't actually panned out.
And to all of you, do you think that it would be more appropriate to keep this out of the courtroom, for instance, until there's a lot more certainty? Or should we be using it now and run the risk that we're reaching potentially wrong conclusions?
I'll jump in first on that and say it's already here. So the idea that we should wait for the science to get better, I think, is just it's too late for that. So the cat's already out of the bag. The question is, what do you do now that it's in the courtroom? Well, we have dueling experts. We have judges who are sitting in a gatekeeping role who have to decide whether or not the evidence should be admissible and whether or not it should be permitted in a case. My view is that the more evidence that we can provide to a jury or to a judge in their decision making, some of it objective evidence, some evidence to help bolster things like a diagnosis of schizophrenia or IQ, all the better. Now, at the same time, we need to have the critics in the courtroom explaining the shortcomings of the science so that we don't have false evidence that's introduced or undue reliance on science that isn't quite there yet. So my preference is recognize it's already there, but make sure that we have robust discussions about the validity of the science before people buy into it too much.
Yeah, I would just add that I basically agree that it's already in the courtroom. However, I would caution that it's not in the courtroom for all uses. Justice Breyer in the Kumho Tyer case, which was the third of the Daubert trilogy, which was basically the Supreme Court's weighing in on the question of the admissibility of scientific evidence or expert evidence more generally, Justice Breyer referred to making sure that the science works for the task at hand. And this notion of the task at hand, I think, ought not to be forgotten, that neuroscience might work for certain tasks very well and for other tasks not so well. And so I think we have to evaluate it on a case-by-case basis. I very much agree with Nita's point that a lot of the neuroscience right now works quite well at the group level and has not yet been shown to work particularly well at the individual level. But having said that, I think that there is, again, a legal necessity issue that's presented. If you go back to Graham versus Florida, it is true that Justice Kennedy and the Supreme Court, the majority of the court, said that you cannot impose life without parole for a non-manslaughter offense for an adolescent. And he drew the line, as he did in Roper versus Simmons, as saying that adolescents are simply different, their brains are different than adults, they're less developmentally mature. But you have to ask the question, well, what happened to Terrence Graham? Well, Terrence Graham got sentenced. Now, he didn't get sentenced to life without parole, which was the default sentence that he was given that was now unconstitutional. And if you actually read what happened at the sentencing hearing for Terrence Graham, there was, again, doing psychologists with a psychiatrist, and the state's psychiatrist made the claim that he was suffering from antisocial personality disorder and that, in his view, nobody recovers from antisocial personality disorder and therefore he should be put away virtually for the rest of his life. And the defense expert said there's already been demonstration of his increased maturity and that I do think that he will mature out of it, and the brain science supported the defense side of that. He got 25 years. That was the sentence. So even though I very much agree, as a constitutional matter, we can draw those bright lines at the group level, in the end, just by necessity, the law has to deal with individuals.
Would you agree that the judicial system is not really the best place for us to be determining whether or not the science behind neuroscience is reliable enough to make judgments? I mean, looking back at things like fingerprints and other tool marks and other sciences, forensic sciences, that came into court and now have been debunked. I mean, isn't there a risk, a huge risk?
Well, there is. I wish that more lawyers knew statistics and research methods. Unfortunately, if you're really good in math, you don't necessarily go to law school. But if you're really good in political science or history, you might go to law school, and you haven't taken math for a very long time. I think the reality is that the courts have to get up to speed. That was really the lesson of the Daubert case. I think it's increasingly becoming the lesson of Kelly Fry as well, is that lawyers, judges, the system more generally, has to be able to evaluate the validity of proffered expert testimony. We just can't get around it. It's in the courtroom. The problem with latent fingerprints and firearms and handwriting and arson investigation, and the list goes on, as you know better than I, the problem was those were never actually evaluated. The courts simply either grandfathered it in or never even bothered to look at it. And I can assure you that the forensic identification sciences, the non-DNA stuff, is not brain science. It doesn't take a Kent Kiel to look at the scientific methods underlying a lot of the forensic techniques and say that it's mostly junk. But I do think your point is well taken, that when you get to genetics and you get to neuroscience and you get to some of the much more complex science, I quite frankly think that law schools need to step up. Lawyers and judges need to step up to do a better job of understanding it. And that's one of the things Kent does. He goes around lecturing judges on the methodology underlying his neuroscience.
Just one note about this. So a lot of the sciences that you mentioned are sciences that were developed not through ordinary scientific method of discovery, but were really directed by the criminal justice system. So these so-called forensic sciences didn't happen from scientists following hypothesis-driven scientific methods and following the scientific method. And neuroscience and DNA are different that way. Now, interestingly, there's a lot of neuroscience collaborations that are happening with people outside of the neuroscientific field, and yet it's still neuroscientists who are doing scientific decision making. So I think the quality of the science is different.
Absolutely.
And as a result, the question of its appropriateness in the courtroom and whether or not we think that it's likely to follow the same fate and path that these so-called other sciences are, I think it's more likely to be like DNA than it is to be like the forensic sciences, which aren't really science to begin with. So I think we can take a little bit of comfort in having it in the courtroom, but also recognizing there's peer-reviewed literature. It's followed the scientific method. We can actually evaluate it in the courtroom, and I completely agree with David that in order to do so, we need to increase the training of lawyers and judges and the general public in these fields so that people are able to critically evaluate the type of science that's introduced in a courtroom.
Yeah, if I could just add very quickly, I absolutely agree with everything that Anita said, but the one area that you sort of have to keep your eye on is fMRI and lie detection. There are two companies now in the business of doing fMRI lie detection, and I think that there the commerce is pushing the science a little bit faster than maybe it ought to.
Yeah.
But I agree.
The science.
The science, yes. Right, exactly.
Okay, we have some questions from the audience that I'd like to ask. And I think most of these are probably for Dr. Keel, but let's see. First question, how does the brain research impact drug cases when the defendant is an addict?
So addiction does, obviously, as most of you know, very bad things to the brain. At least it dramatically changes the brain. So that's certain individuals there's enormous vulnerabilities and risk factors from genetics to brain structure and function that can precipitate or make it to be easier to get addicted to drugs. There have been, I think, quite a bit of neuroscience focusing on trying to develop better treatments for individuals by understanding the mechanism of those changes. In the courtroom, I believe that, to help judges, when we do the education, one of my collaborators who does this work teaches them all about how the brain changes with addiction, et cetera, and that might be very helpful for judges when it comes to sentencing someone to, like, drug courts for an addiction problem versus, prison for long periods of time. That is, if their primary problem really is one of addiction, then treatment and remediation of that, and then the subsequent, behavioral problems and other things is probably far more cost-effective and good thing for that person than just simply sentencing them to prison time. And so I think the neuroscience helps to educate and change our way that we understand, drugs and drug addiction.
Okay. And another question is, have you ever been allowed to testify regarding IQ in a hearing or a trial using your program?
Yeah, so I just did that this weekend. So I haven't testified this morning. Do know that, so the Atkins case was actually argued by a professor at the University of New Mexico, and he's constantly barraged by what's the best way to assess IQ, especially when you have these different tests and different measures, et cetera. And IQ is one of the most well-studied things in psychology. So taking a brain scan and fitting your brain along a dimension and then getting a value is just a slightly different way of doing it than giving you the tests and stuff like that. So I have not obviously testified to anything like that. I just tried to do that as an example. There is an enormous literature out there that's already been peer-reviewed and published on the brain correlates of IQ. There's dozens of papers. The big question, which Anita and David is working on this as well, alluded to, is that how well can I take a single person's brain scan and with what confidence can I get a number associated with it that we would derive an IQ? And those measures and ways that we do that get better every month, basically. Every year, we're getting more and more and more accurate at taking a single piece of information or complex piece of information and fitting it. To my knowledge, it hasn't been done. I am aware that there are patents on estimating IQ using spectroscopic brain imaging, which is a measure of metabolites in the brain. I'm not aware of any cases in which it's been used, but there's no reason why it couldn't be.
I mean, the way it's been, nothing, as you've described, the algorithms to actually map it have been used. But in IQ cases, brain imaging has been used to try to bolster a claim of lower IQ, not by an algorithm, but by trying to show brain abnormalities and differences that would be consistent with a diagnosis of mental retardation or of lower IQ.
Yeah, I would just add to that. This is actually an area that partnerships between lawyers and scientists could really make a difference. I teach constitutional law, and the question I ask is, why is low IQ an excusing condition from the death penalty? And if you go back to Atkins and you read the opinion, it's on the basis of an Eighth Amendment analysis of the twin pillars of the criminal law, which are retribution and deterrence, and the court makes the judgment that low IQ means that you're less responsible and you're less likely to be able to be deterred, and so the twin pillars of the criminal law don't really apply. But I'm not sure that the psychologists who do psychological testing and IQ or the neuroscientists have really connected up the constitutional reasons why, because it may be that there are substructures of IQ that are more relevant to the Eighth Amendment question. It's not a general IQ score that's ultimately relevant. And in fact, the California Supreme Court has dealt with exactly that question of, you know, what subscales might be constitutionally relevant rather than the global IQ score.
And one question here, which I think is very interesting. In my community, we strongly feel that diet plays a strong diagnosis of the violence we see. The intake of sugar, which is heavily consumed, is a factor. What is your take on that?
Well, diet certainly plays a role in controlling and behavior and so that. You know, there's I'm not that familiar with all the different science associated with different dietary restrictions and other types of things. You can certainly reduce the incidence of aggression in animal models and other types of things by putting them on different diets. You can certainly make animals more likely to, you know, by experimentally changing diets, more likely to be aggressive, for example. I have a sister who's a nutritionist just around the corner here, and so she would have kill me if I didn't tell you that you should eat right, you know? That being said, I do believe that deficits in certain, you know, essential amino acids and other types of things can certainly increase people's impulsivity. They can increase people's, you know, chances of not those types of things. So, yeah.
And one final question, and I'm going to rephrase it a little bit, but why is it that we treat people who have, say, traumatic brain injuries or other diagnosed mental illnesses in the criminal justice system rather than in the mental health system? I mean.
So what I showed you today was to give you that exact, what is neuroscience doing in the legal system? And so the picture of the person with the tumor, you could all see that, and so can a radiologist. But the analysis that we do now of those images, no radiologist can just see by looking at them. But we are so sensitive to individual differences in IQ, in age, and all these different variables, psychopathy scores, whatever it is, we can develop beautiful pictures of these things. And so the question is, how is the legal system going to deal with all of these different, you know, images and other types of things that we can now tell you about your brain, and then how is that going to change things? So I tend to view, you know, individuals who have brain differences for whatever reason worthy of developing better treatments for them that can help to remediate those problems. As psychologists, we study abnormal behavior. So Nita shows you this distribution. Most of us are in here. But if you get anybody out here who's too, like, externalizing, or anyone out here who's too internalizing, as psychologists, we try to bring them back in here so they're more healthy. And so that's what we study. We try to figure out, when you're out there and having problems in your life or any other area, if we can do something, talking to you versus talk therapy or medicine that might help you, what we're trying to do is get everybody back here so we're just kind of more balanced. And with respect to the traumatic brain injuries and other types of things, well, that's much simpler for people to kind of understand that you had a concussive event or you had a TBI, a traumatic brain injury, it's caused problems. And we should be developing ways of helping to manage and treat those problems just like we do individuals who have the other types of problems.
Let me just add one thing there, which is, this is it's a good question, but it highlights one of the challenges of introducing neuroscience today in the courtroom. As Kent showed you with some of his slides and mentioned during his talk, he's trying to develop treatments as he develops abilities to diagnose psychopathy. But that's what comes first, is the diagnosis. And if that's what's introduced first before there are any treatments available, which is the status of much of the neuroscience today, then there isn't a treatment that's available. And so part of the problem today is it tends to serve as an aggravating factor because you can't say, well, here's a simple way to fix that thing that we've identified. In the few cases where defendants have been able to show that they've been successfully treated, like, for example, if they were unaware that they had intermittent explosive disorder and it could be treated with an antidepressant, an SSRI, because of their low serotonin levels, for example, and they show that their behavior has changed since they've been in prison awaiting trial or, you know, after they were convicted but now appealing a death sentence, in those cases, it's had more traction. And so it makes sense to say we should really focus on treatment, but it's a cautionary tale, which is if it's introduced before treatment is available, how are juries likely to receive that information? They're likely to receive it as a person saying, I am somebody who is programmed to be violent, and there is no solution for my particular ailment. So, you know, there's a disconnect in the neuroscience given the timing.
So I would just comment and say that I think we do have pretty decent treatments for remediating even some of the most intractable individuals. They're not used around the world, et cetera, and many countries take individuals who have done very bad things as youth and have developed management and treatment strategies that keep them from, you know, reoffending it when they're out in the community. They're much more managerial. There's much more supervision than we typically get in the United States. But it's usually much more cost-effective to manage them outside of a facility with high scrutiny than it is to incarcerate. I mean, as you probably know, California spends about 8 times as much money for every inmate as it does for every student at the University of California system. And so you could reorganize those resources and put them more towards, you know, supervision and other types of things and manage a lot of those individuals who are currently incarcerated in a much more effective way that's going to save you tax dollars but also reduce the chances that they'll continue to spiral into those, like the stories we heard earlier today.
Right.
If I could just add one quick thought, that really ties together the first panel and this panel, and it's a question of resource allocation, and I think Nita's point needs to be taken quite seriously, especially with adolescents. If you get the diagnosis and the community is not ready to step up and do the interventions right. that are more humane, then the inhumane alternatives might end up costing more but being the easy political solution.
Sure.
And I think we're out of time, so I'd like to thank everyone on the panel for their time.